Hi, welcome replay viewers, welcome live viewers. This is Janice, and we are at Twin Oaks, Frederick Douglass's summer home. And can I at least say your name? Okay, so Jean Langston is going to be narrating. Oh, thank you for joining, guys. So please invite and share this out. And we're going to have a tour, a special tour today for you guys. So you can go ahead and start.
All right, this house was built by Charles Douglass's the youngest son of Frederick Douglass. It was completed in 1895. But prior to that time, it was Charles and his wife Laura who ventured over into an area that is called Bay Ridge today. And this area was designated for whites only. It was a private community. And they had an amusement park and a variety of activities for people who were non-white. Who were white only. This, as we found the story, Laura and Charles ventured over to Bay Ridge and were turned away because of segregation in those days. And there's a small creek here called Black Walnut Creek. They walked, came across the creek. At that time it was a little bit wider and had a little bridge that came across. And they came back and met a farmer here whose name was Brashears. And they, the Douglass name was very prominent during those times because of Frederick Douglass and all that he had done. So this was in the summer, and the following year, Charles was able to purchase this land and called it Highland Beach. Initially it was 40 acres, but there was a problem with a young heir who wasn't old enough to sell her share of the property. So he ended up with 26 and two-thirds acres. The land was divided into subplots, 50 by 150 feet, and sold to family and friends.
I'm going to go down and show them the house. Turn my phone sideways. I'll turn my phone sideways. So this is the house.
There's the balcony here that Frederick wanted to sit on and look across the bay to where he was born a slave.
Oh, the balcony right here?
No, upstairs.
Oh, you're welcome. And he wanted to look out over here?
The bay to where he was born a slave.
Oh, he wanted to look out to where he was born a slave? That's Eastern Shore? Oh my God, wow. That's Eastern Shore over there. So he wanted to look out to where he was born a slave. That is amazing.
I've come to full circle. I want to sit on this side of it.
That's amazing. So this is the Frederick Douglass Museum and Cultural Center now. And so, no, this is a museum. Nobody lives here. So designed by Frederick Douglass so that as a free man, I could look across the bay to the land where I was born. And it was built by his youngest son.
Charles
Redmond Douglass, Remond. So this is, I think that's interesting because the Remonds were in Boston. The other abolitionist family.
He picked some of the names from people that he knew.
Because that's the interest. That's the only way I've seen it spelled. That's interesting. So we're inside now, you guys.
This originally was the living room area, and you'll notice that the walls, floors, and ceiling are all made of wood. During those days, many of the houses in this area were predominantly wood because of the fact that it was summer-only property. And it was amazing, 35 years after slavery, people of color could own two homes.
Wow, that's a good point.
Yes, 35 years after slavery.
35 years after slavery, people of color could own two homes.
Wow. So they used this as a pretty much as a retreat. Many of the close up around Labor Day to go back to work. The men would usually come in on weekends and stay with the families.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. So I had a phone call. I declined it. Are you guys back on? Is it okay? Give me a one if the connection is good. Okay, they're back.
So this room was basically the living room for the family, and this is the family who lived in the house after Frederick died. He died February the 20th, 1895, the winter before the house was completed. So he never actually lived in this house, but he oversaw the construction of it. And this is Joseph, the grandson, his wife Fanny, and she lived to be 103 years old.
Wow.
And the granddaughter and the grandson.
And what was their last name?
Douglas.
Oh.
That was Joseph Douglas.
Joseph Douglas.
This is Joseph Douglas, the son of Charles.
The son of Charles.
Who discovered Highland Beach.
Okay. Wow.
And he was an accomplished violinist, and his wife taught music in DC public schools.
Really?
And this little guy grew up to be married, the daughter kept prominent families. And Booker T.
He married the daughter of Booker T. Washington. So he's related to Kenneth Morris?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And what is his name again?
That's, wait a minute, hold on.
Okay,
I'll get it in a minute.
That's Kim Morris's great-great-grand.
This is Frederick.
That's Frederick.
Douglas.
Frederick Douglass. So,
and Blanche is this little girl's name.
And that's Blanche.
And Blanche died at the age of 10 after drinking contaminated well water here in Highland Beach.
Oh, no. Oh, my goodness. That's so sad.
And that's Joseph.
Okay.
With his grandfather.
Okay.
And he was so happy. He had only had one grandson who really enjoyed the violin as much as he did. And that was Joseph.
Okay. And is this, that's the violin?
That is a replica.
A replica? Okay.
Type of violin. This is Miss Fanny as I remember her.
Oh,
and
wow.
And this is her piano.
And she's, so that is her at 100 and something.
She was in the 90s here.
In the 90s. Wow. And that's her piano.
That's her piano.
Oh,
and
amazing.
Her stool and some of the music that she played.
Wow. Wow, that's incredible.
And this is the trunk that Frederick Douglass used. It's on loan to us from the National Park Service.
Really?
And he used it to travel a lot. He did do an awful lot of traveling, and three times across the Atlantic Ocean to Europe. The first time was after he wrote his first book, Narrative of a Slave, by Frederick Douglass.
Wow.
And the slave hunters were coming after him because he revealed his real identity, which wasn't Frederick Douglass at all. He was born Frederick Augustus Washington Bailey.
Yes.
And as a result of that, he gave away his identity.
Oh.
So the slave hunters were coming after him, and he had enough money from the abolitionists to help him go abroad. So in going there, he visited a number of people that the abolitionists put him in touch with, and giving speeches and so forth.
Yes.
And this may have been the trunk that he used on one of his travels. We're not really sure which ones, but that's one of his trunks.
Okay. Wow.
And the second time he was left the United States because the marshals thought he was in cahoots with John Brown at Harper's Ferry.
Oh.
And he had convinced. And
he went to Canada.
He went to Canada
to meet with John Brown. And then
later they found out he didn't. During that time is when his 10-year-old daughter Annie died.
Oh.
So he came back to the States. The third time was when he got married after his wife, his first wife died. And Blanche K. Bruce, first black senator from Mississippi, served as his best man.
Oh, wow.
And his wife served as a witness for his wife, second wife, Helen.
Okay.
And the cigar case probably was loaded with cigars at the time, but that's the actual note that Blanche wrote to Frederick.
Oh, wow.
And the cigar case that he gave him as a wedding gift.
Amazing.
Over here. Oldest son. I mean, this is Frederick at 36 years of age.
Okay, Frederick Douglass at age 36.
And that's Frederick Douglass' later life.
Okay.
His sister, Rosetta.
Okay.
And his other brother, Louis. Except for the, this is Joseph down at the bottom. This is Charles' son, Douglass, who was the grandson, who was
which
mayor.
Of Highland Beach?
Of Highland Beach.
Really? Okay. Can I get down here? There's Charles Frederick Douglass, son of Mary and Elizabeth Douglass. Harriet Bailey Sprague. And... okay. And then up here are the descendants. Douglas descendants, all the names are listed, mm-hmm. and the grandchildren. Wow. Oh, and there's his speech.
Mm-hmm.
His famous speech, "What to the Slave is the 4th of July." Wow.
And I have it printed out here.
Oh, okay.
So
this is printed where? Rochester, New York. Yeah. So that's the actual copy?
That's a print.
It's a print?
Yes.
Okay.
It didn't look like a...
Oh, okay. I was wondering why it was
torn
like that.
And this is the game table that belonged to Frederick Douglass. It was in a Cedar Hill house.
Oh, wait. I don't think I got Mary, Anna and Mary.
Oh, okay.
I'm missing the wives. We're missing the wives.
This is Anna.
That's Anna.
Anna was the one who was very helpful in helping Frederick escape to the north. She sold her feather bed to get enough money to buy cloth to make him a sailor's uniform.
Okay.
And she
eventually his first wife.
Yes, his first wife.
And this is his second wife.
Helen Pitts Douglas. How he met her. Her father was an abolitionist.
Okay.
So he said, I married the first wife after the color of my mother. I married the second after the color of my father. I've come full circle.
Oh, did he really
say that?
That's
what he said, that especially when the kids, none of her family or his family came to the marriage.
Ah.
They're not very happy about
it. Well, yeah, I know. I heard that they weren't happy. So that's the Douglas family tree,
mm-hmm.
the complete family tree
as much
there.
As we have.
Yes. Wow, that's interesting. Yes, his father was white,
mm-hmm.
and that's not really talked about.
No, it isn't.
Yeah, I mean, well, you can look at his nose and tell. So he definitely has a European nose. But yeah, that is not mentioned at all. Mm-hmm. So what year is this?
This is a Harper's Ferry. This was nine.
Oh, that's a Harper's? Harper's Ferry?
Not Harper's Ferry, the Harper's Weekly magazine.
Oh, Harper's Weekly magazine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Someone did that and colored it.
Okay. So is this an original Frederick Douglass table?
This came from the Cedar Hill House in Washington, D.C.
Oh, really? So I love visiting the home in Anacostia, in D.C.
Yes.
And my children participate in the Douglass Auditoria Contest every year. Awesome. Well, this comes from that house.
Yes.
That's
what he used to play cards and games with his grandchildren.
Okay, so he used this to play cards and games with his grandchildren. Wow.
And seated on this table, we
mm-hmm.
have Frederick, who is sitting there looking across the bay to where he was born a slave.
Ah, okay, so he's looking across... where he was born a slave. So that's the eastern shore on the other side. The Cedar Hill House in D.C. has about 80% original pieces of Douglass.
Mm-hmm. And here is the Cedar Hill House.
Oh, okay. And they have a picture of the Cedar Hill House here.
Yes. I have glare on it from the lights. Oh.
So, no, it's okay. It's okay. Yeah, you don't have to disturb it.
And the table that he's sitting on belonged to his very dear friend, Mary Church Terrell.
Oh, really? Mary Church Terrell? Well, love. Okay.
It was her dining room table.
This was her dining room table.
Wow. And this was one of her dining room table sets.
Oh, the china?
The china belonged to her as well as the table and chairs.
As well as the table and chairs belonged to Mary Church Terrell, or Terrell.
It's pronounced it Terrell.
Terrell. Okay. Wow. Wow, that's awesome. It's beautiful. Fierce advocate and educator. Yes, she was. The British castle dinerware and table and chairs. She was a close friend of Frederick Douglass and persuaded her. He persuaded her to purchase the lot
next to him.
She lived next door in the house that you're in? Oh my God, really? Okay.
And this is the house. That's her house.
Oh, wow. So she had a house here too.
Yes, right next door.
Amazing. Wow. That's incredible.
My mother-in-law was Phyllis, who was her daughter.
Your mother-in-law was Phyllis, who was her daughter? Mm-hmm. And so can I show you then for a second?
Oh, yes, my God.
I'm trying to get a, okay, that's much better. So now we can see Jean. So she said, awesome. So she's a descendant of Mary Church.
My husband is.
Your husband.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm married into the family.
Okay. You married into the family.
Yes.
I am in Maryland. I'm in Highland Beach, Maryland, which is near Annapolis. That's where we are. Okay. So who?
This is Charles Douglass's house.
That's Charles Douglass's house?
Mm-hmm. It went down in 1949.
Okay.
This is the Bowen Cottage, which was designed by George Bowen, who was a former slave.
Oh, really?
It's a guest house. Many people enjoyed coming, including Booker T. Washington, County Cullen, and a few others.
Really? Wow. It's only open by appointment. It's only open by appointment. It's not open on a regular basis.
No.
You have to call and make an appointment. You will visit with your family. Okay. Yeah, it's definitely worth, your kids will enjoy it. Is there a website?
Yes, highlandbeachmd.org.
highlandbeachmd.org. Yeah.
And this is the original sign. All the houses here had names.
Okay.
And this was named Twin Oaks. And that's the original sign that was out front.
You live in Waldorf, you'll definitely visit. Awesome.
At Wayman Avenue.
Oh, this original sign for Wayman Avenue. Wow. So these original signs. Okay, so.
This is Frederick meeting President Abraham Lincoln.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Yes, highlandbeachmd.org. Correct, that's it. So this is Frederick Douglass at the White House by John N. Robinson. Meeting President Lincoln in July 1863. Yes, that's it, Fit Baker Mom, thank you. To discuss equal treatment for the colored soldiers serving in the Civil War. Wow. Frederick Douglass, Senator Samuel Pomeroy, President Abraham Lincoln, seated David Wells, Special Agent, William H. Seward, Secretary of State, Edwin M. Stanton, Secretary of War, Francis Blair, Secretary of Treasury.
And look at the body language. Pretty much like we...
Yeah. Douglass and his sons recruited heavily for the Civil War. Yes. They did, at the meeting house.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, they had in Boston. Hey, Ketchy.
And this is a lady who actually did the sculpture for us. Her name is Vinnie Bagwell.
Vinnie Bagwell, okay. So she did the sculpture that's here.
Yes.
Oh, okay, you have
and
that.
That's on the back.
Oh.
Douglas and all of his portraits.
Okay, so this is Kenneth Morris. Yes, yes.
He's coming next week, 2 weeks from now?
Yes, yes, he will be in D.C.
Yes.
So we need to meet him, you guys, those who are around. And where is this Frederick Douglass statue?
I think this is the one. I'm not sure where. This is the one in Rochester, New York.
Oh, that's in Rochester?
Yeah, that's the one in Rochester.
Okay, so that's... Are you going to look her up? Awesome. That's in Rochester. And then... That's Fanny?
Fanny. Mm-hmm.
With who? Who is she with? Yeah, Rochester.
With Kenneth Morris, the young... And Fanny Douglass. Picture left or right. Kenneth Morris, Fanny Douglass, and Douglass Washington Morris.
Okay. So, which one is Kenneth? The little one or the older one?
The older one.
Okay, so that's Kenneth Morris.
And that's Kenneth Morris.
Yeah. I saw him holding a picture of Frederick Douglass, and he looked exactly like
mm-hmm.
him.
Mm-hmm.
It is incredible. Oh, my God. It's incredible. Wow. Wow.
And that's Joseph.
And that's Joseph.
This whole book is famous.
Oh, amazing.
But this is the title. Picture.
Oh, this is picturing Frederick Douglass.
Yes,
yes, there are powerful genes. Whoever the European man is that they haven't discovered is the one dictating those genes, probably. It's either him or the wife, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But that nose.
That nose.
Yeah, it is. It's that nose, that European nose. Yeah. There are some powerful genes.
She got all the way down to the shoelaces.
Wow.
And this is a sign that normally sits in his hand, but it keeps falling in the water.
Oh, what's on the sign? On the sign? Okay. So on the sign, it says, until color shall cease to bar, to be a bar to equal participation in the offices and honor of the country, this discussion shall go on until the American people shall make character, not color, the criteria of respectability. This discussion shall go on.
Yep.
Wow. And I'm going to show you guys the back. What did you say? Let's see. Okay, so you guys know that this symbol represents abolitionism. The slave on the bended knee. So, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, that's a better picture. You can see the photo better with the white background. Yeah. So that's from that period.
Yes, this room. Floor.
Oh, okay.
And this was the post office. And raised the window when it was time to give the mail to the children who assembled on the porch.
Wow.
Most of the mail in the summertime were postcards and that kind of stuff, but they
used
it as a gathering spot before they went to the beach.
How long is the drive to Highland Beach? She's in near Silver Spring, I think.
40 minutes.
About 40 minutes.
40, 50 minutes.
Yeah, it's probably about an hour.
1340, that's the John R. Francis house.
Oh, okay.
1896, it was finished.
1896? Wow.
That's
a big house for 1896.
Yep, they've had some more work done on it recently, but that so was finished in 1896. Third generation family.
Third generation.
100-year-old mom.
You have a 100-year-old mom? Oh, my goodness.
This one?
Okay.
That's him standing outside the Bowen cottage. And this is George Bowen here.
Oh. I'll give you the number, Tisha Love. I'll give you the number. I'll give you her information, okay? Oh, more china.
Yeah, that's the rest of the set.
Wow. And so is this kitchen pretty authentic?
No, this kitchen was a porch.
Oh, it was a porch?
Added the kitchen.
Okay.
Because the kitchen was a little tiny space here. There.
Oh.
This was not a door at the time. We have all kinds of interesting memorabilia.
Yeah, it is. It's a little cash register.
His Uncle Sam saving Nichols.
And what are these trophies?
Some of the trophies were won by people during various July 4th Labor Day weekend celebrations.
Okay.
And this was a professor of anatomy at Howard University. That was his lantern he used for fishing on the pier.
Oh.
And this is his champagne bottle. He won that in one of the activities.
Okay.
And he drank the champagne and nailed the bottle to the wall in his kitchen. And the rolling pin.
Yeah. What is that?
A microscope.
A microscope? Who used the microscope?
It was used in Dr. Cobb's classes.
Oh. That's a meat grinder?
That's a meat grinder.
Yeah. Who's calling? Who's pressing cones?
That belonged to...
Okay, wow.
And the ice tongs belonged to my husband's father.
Okay. Look at the... What is this? That's a washing machine.
That's a rocker washing machine.
A what kind?
It's called a rocker washer.
A rocker? I haven't seen one this old. Uh-oh.
Yeah. And originally, when you put the clothes in, you had to actually rock it to wash the clothes. Because
that's
the electricity. Oh, wow. Electricity in the area in 1935. So they added a motor to it so they wouldn't have to rock it to wash. Because they were washing all the clothes, sheets and stuff.
I remember that.
For the... for the Bowen Cottage.
Oh, okay. Wow. And who's
that belonged to Dr. Osborne T. Taylor.
Okay.
Who purchased the other lots that is now in this beach.
Look at the irons. Oh my god.
They belong to Mary Church Terrell.
The irons belong to Mary Church Terrell? Wow. Mm-hmm.
Wow. And that surveying equipment was actually used to survey up the lots in what is now Venice Beach, which is our sister community, by Osborne T. Taylor, who purchased the land in 1922.
Okay.
The same year that Highland Beach was incorporated. So we have our own mayor, our own commissioners.
Really?
On Board of Elections. I'm the chief of Board of Elections.
You're the chief of the Board of the Elections?
We have a lot of hats.
Oh my goodness.
Director of the museum, Board of Elections.
Oh god. Look, lye soap, you guys.
Yeah, lye soap.
Oh my goodness.
And that's Haley Douglas in the picture.
Haley Douglas?
Yeah, in his
boat. Oh, okay.
And he was the mayor.
He was the mayor?
Yeah.
I'm trying to
and
zoom
he taught,
in.
He taught
there we go.
History at Dunbar High School.
My goodness.
In the wash.
Yeah, I know.
And the dipper to go along with the pump.
Yes. Where was the well?
The well was over, that came from, I'm trying to remember whose house, the Montague Cobb's house and the dipper.
Okay.
The tub came from the Say House, which is the house on the corner. It tore down and built another mega house.
Yes.
So that came from that house.
Okay.
And the croquet set came from the Hendersons across the street, and the wagon came from the Hendersons.
Oh, that is a wagon.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my goodness.
And the
wow.
two men saw many of the saws that were used to build some of these houses.
The saw was used to build the houses?
Some of the houses.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. Wow. Wow, that's incredible.
I see the lawnmower. Everything is stacked on top.
Oh, that is, yeah. It's an old lawnmower. Interesting artifacts. Hi, how are you doing? Okay.
Notice
this out of step swing. I have to be careful with the number of people because they're not reinforced.
Oh.
Underneath.
Okay.
I can only have like one or two people on the steps at a time due to the weight.
Wow. So this is where he would sit.
Yeah, that's where he wanted to sit.
Wow. To look out across. This is incredible. So Frederick Douglass sat here. I don't want to stop the broadcast. To look out across. And it's the eastern shore over there. And so this is the summer home. And then next door to him is the, why am I zoomed in so much? Okay, there we go, that's better. So this is the home of Mary Church Terrell, next door neighbors. And we would not have known if we had not come. And family, and family. So family. This is his porch. This is the porch he sat on. So that's the porch, and he would look out across the water. So that's amazing. Oh, there's his chair. A picture of him in the chair, Frederick Douglass. And there's his chair. So, Eastern Shore is where he was born a slave.
Yeah, Talbot County.
Talbot County. Yeah. So he would sit and look out. And look at where he had come.
Mm-hmm. He said, I've come full circle.
44 years. So he printed this?
Yeah. I'm not sure who printed that. Wait a minute. Information?
Okay.
No, the Afro.
Oh, the Afro printed this. Afro. Okay.
We do have something from the North Star. I'm not sure where it is.
Wow. Oh, that's nice that they did that. So this was the bedroom.
This was the bedroom.
Okay, so let me.
And they had twin beds from what I understand from talking to Kenny. Mark.
He and Anna had twin beds?
No, Anna did not stay in this house.
Anna didn't stay in this house.
She died before this house was even.
Okay, she.
She died in 72.
Okay. So Helen. And Frederick had twin beds.
No, Helen never stayed in this house.
So who Frederick had twin beds?
Fanny Douglas's grandchildren. Frederick, see, it was...
Okay, so did Frederick Douglass come and sit on the porch?
He sat on the porch. He helped design the house, but he died in February before the house was able to live in because this was a summer-only community.
Oh, he didn't get to sit to live in the house.
No, he never lived in the house.
Okay.
He helped design the house.
He helped design the house, but he never lived
in the house because he died.
Okay.
In February.
Okay.
And he would have come that following June.
He died in February. Wow. Yeah. Wow. Well, at least he got to help design it.
Yeah, he designed it.
A register and index of his papers in the Library of Congress. Wow. Highland Beach, 1990 was the 100th birthday.
Okay. It was 120 some years now. And this is Frederick. And John Brown.
Okay.
Well, I thought he was in cahoots with John Brown.
Well, he went to the meeting, he did. I know
he met with him like 2 weeks before the incident.
Right,
and
right.
He was trying to convince him to come join, but he refused.
John Mercer Langston birthplace. The plantations of Captain Ralph Quarles were located approximately 4 miles. Thank you for showing this home in history. You're welcome. You're welcome. Brian says thank you. And one of Captain Quarles' plantations was situated on the branch of Goldmine Creek near White Creek. The other plantation, he built another home for himself and one for his companion, Lucy Jane Langston, and was located on the headwaters of the North Branch of Hickory Creek, about 3 miles from Quarles' other plantation on White Creek. The plantation located on the North Branch of Hickory Creek was the early childhood home and probable birthplace of John Mercer Langston. The remains of a house dwelling and a barn are visible today as the burial sites of Captain Quarles and Lucy Jane Langston. Okay, so this is your husband's family.
Yes.
Okay, John Mercer Langston.
And also Langston Hughes is part of the family. That's Langston Hughes at the bottom.
So you're related to Langston Hughes?
Yes.
What?
Well, I'm not. My husband is.
Well, your husband is. Oh, my goodness. Wow. That is incredible.
His originally, he was John Mercer Langston Hughes, and he dropped the John Mercer part. Or James Langston Hughes. His mother was a Langston. He used her maiden name as his middle name.
Okay, so how far down is Langston Hughes from John Mercer Langston?
I'd have to get the...
Okay, you have to get out the family
tree.
Okay. That is amazing. Well, that There's so
uncle.
Much...
That was his uncle.
That was his... Langston Hughes was your husband's uncle?
Langston Hughes was John... was the nephew of John Mercer Langston.
Okay. Langston Hughes is the nephew of John Mercer Langston. You know, yeah, Langston is not a very popular name. I should have known something when I kept calling you. Oh my God, that's incredible. That is incredible. So catchy. So you guys, not only do we have the Douglasses, we have the Langston family. And the Mary Church Terrell family. Okay, so Mary Church Terrell is related to Langston Howe again?
No.
What's
my husband who's a Langston Mary? And let me start.
Yeah. So explain the relationship because I'm lost.
Phyllis Terrell, my husband's mother-in-law, my husband's stepmom, married Langston, Lethal Langston. That's how we got the family joined.
No, they live next door. So
the Terrell family married the Langston family. That's how they were connected.
Okay, Terrell family married the Langston family, and the Mary Terrell is a friend of Frederick Douglass. He persuaded her to move next door. So we can show you the house right here. So the house next door is where they lived. So did the Langstons have a house up here too?
Well, it's the Langston Terrell house.
Oh, it is the Langston Terrell house. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to follow it.
Lethal Langston, who's my husband's father, married Phyllis Terrell.
Phyllis Terrell. Okay.
She became Phyllis Terrell Langston.
Phyllis Terrell Langston.
So the Langston and the Terrells.
Wow. So the Langston and the Terrells have married. The Booker T. Washingtons and the Frederick Douglasses have married. Okay. So they just keep it all in the family. And this is the bedroom where Kenneth
and his sister and her brother slept.
Where Kenneth Morris slept with his brother. Okay. And Kenneth Morris is the
great-great-great-grandson of Frederick Douglass.
Great-great-grandson of Frederick Douglass. Okay. And what are these pictures of?
That's Charles Douglass's house. I think you got that earlier.
Charles Douglass's house. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm glad you guys are enjoying it.
And that's the girls from Camp Camp Clarissa Scott used to come every morning during the summer to bathe in the Chesapeake Bay. And this particular time they were sitting on a car. It was around in the 1930s.
Okay.
Before I was born.
Okay.
And that's the pavilion where they used to have all kinds of activities.
Okay.
From Sunday school to movies to dances and parties and so forth. And that's Booker T. Washington again.
Booker T. Washington at the Bowen.
At the Bowen Cottage.
Bowen Cottage. So Booker T. Washington at the Bowen. Okay.
And this used to be a bedroom.
Oh, okay.
The wall was taken down.
So this was a bedroom.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, all of them. Yes, yes. They're all connected. We didn't know. None of us knew they were all connected. Because when you learn about them in history, they're all separate. You don't learn that their connection you don't learn their connection at all. So is this all original furniture?
This was purchased by one of a group that came through and wanted to give us a wash stand so we could show Frederick Douglass's wash basin.
Oh, this is his wash basin?
It actually belonged to him in Cedar Hill.
Oh, this is from Cedar Hill, Frederick Douglass's wash basin.
On loan to us.
Oh, okay. From the Frederick Douglass National Historic Site. Oh, I'll hold the wash. Okay, go ahead and take a photo again. I'm sorry, I moved. So you can get the photo of it. Did you get the picture? Okay, there you go. All right. Okay, so that's when he was a statesman. In what year? No, is Frederick Douglass in there? No.
No.
Oh, he's not in there.
No, those are just
the first colored senator and representatives in the 41st and 42nd Congress of the United States.
That was during Reconstruction.
Reconstruction, yes. And they were Republicans at that time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And this is a bird's eye view of where you are.
This is
Highland Beach here.
Okay.
And we are here.
Oh, wow.
This is the creek. And this is our lot here.
Wow. Wow, that's amazing. And so this area
That's Bay Ridge.
Bay Ridge. Mm-hmm. And they could not...
They couldn't venture over there.
Yeah, because it was...
Segregated.
They could only be on this side. That's amazing.
And these steps...
I've never seen steps made like this. They look like shoeboxes or something.
It used to be a ladder that went up, but when Chip Bowl designed it, he got permission to put this in. Because it's a historic house, you have to get special permission.
Yes.
To do something different.
Yes.
So these are called alternating steps. He saw them in Scandinavian country.
Oh.
So you have to work in these cubbies. But we have to have a way to get to the air conditioning and all the
stuff.
So.
Okay. Interesting. Well, they're very steep.
Very hard to get up and down.
I can imagine. It's got to be like crawling.
Mm-hmm. And this room is being archived. So in process.
Oh, wow.
And that's Mary Church Terrell. And that's her on the picket line when she was 89 years old.
Really?
Yes.
89?
And she integrated the stores in Washington, D.C.
She integrated the stores in Washington?
Helped integrate the stores.
Wow. Wow.
Her hat, her gloves and stuff are on now at the new Smithsonian.
Are they?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm going to have to go and look for it again. That is incredible.
So
we
have two young ladies who are in the process of archiving this stuff.
Wow. Thanks for sharing and inviting you guys. Thanks, Claudette.
So this is Easton. This is where he was born. Wow.
Yeah, I was in the process of trying to put the map together.
It's amazing.
And here's Booker T.
Oh, Booker T. Washington. Yes.
There is no struggle, there is no progress.
Yes. It's so true. I don't know if you guys can see. Oh, here, maybe you can. You can see it now. Greetings. How are you doing? How are you doing, Claudette? Thanks for joining and sharing. Thank you. And that's Frederick Douglass. There is no struggle. There is no progress. Those who profess to favor freedom and yet depreciate agitation are men who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. They want the ocean without the awful roar of its many waters. This struggle may be a moral one, or it may be a physical one, or it may be both moral and physical, but it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did, and it never will. Wow. Find out what people will submit to, and you have found the exact amount of injustice and wrong which will be opposed upon them. And these will continue until they are resisted with either words or blows or with both. The limits of tyrants are prescribed by the endurance of those whom they oppress. Frederick Douglass. Wow. Hi, Jeff. How are you doing? Oh, my goodness. Welcome. Welcome. Thanks for joining. Yeah, that's very powerful, isn't it? So what is this a picture of?
Hampton University. Hampton.
Hampton University?
Well, it's Hampton University now. It's Hampton College.
Hampton College.
Where they dressed. Look at the...
I know. Wow. That's incredible. And then there's another picture of Frederick Douglass. Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for sharing. So this is Frederick Douglass's summer home. And yes, thanks. Thank you guys for sharing. Thanks for coming in. Can we see the one underneath? This is amazing. Oh, what is this a picture of?
Your Church Terrell on her 90th birthday.
89th birthday. Some close-ups so you can get screenshots. Okay, so this is pretty rare. This is Mary Church Terrell on her
89th birthday.
89th birthday. Okay, I'm holding it. We're holding it. You guys got pictures? Okay, screenshot. You got it? 89th birthday. Thank you. And what else do we have there?
Her court battles.
Her court battles. Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. So Mary Church Terrell and three companions, one of whom was white, sought service at Thompson Restaurant in downtown Washington, D.C. The non-whites were refused service. January 27, 1950. February 28, 1950, Terrell and her colleagues returned to the restaurant only to be turned away again because of their color. July 10, 1950, the suit filed in the municipal court by Mrs. Terrell, Reverend Arthur Elms, S.E. Thompson, and David Skoll, white, against Thompson's restaurant for its policy of discrimination was dismissed. May 24, 1951, a challenge of the lower court ruling made to the Municipal Court of Appeals by the district commissioner resulted in a reversal of the municipal court decision. The laws were enforceable. January 22, 1953, the United States Court of Appeals ruled in favor of Thompson's Restaurant in its appeal to reverse the decision of the Municipal Court of Appeals. This is amazing and heartbreaking at the same time. It is.
I agree with you. June 8, 1953, U.S. Supreme Court, by a unanimous decision, came to the following conclusion. We have said that the acts of 1872 and 1873 survived the intervening changes in government of the District of Columbia and are presently enforceable. This decision meant victory at last for the committee and the hundreds of individuals and organizations who fought the three-year battle to have the 1872 to 1873 anti-discrimination laws enforced in Washington, D.C. The headline in the June 13, 1953 issue of the Washington Afro-American newspaper simply stated, "Eat anywhere." Wow.
And that's the timeline.
Okay, so these are the places that Mary Church Terrell helped to desegregate. From 1949 to 1953, September 1950, G.C. Murphy's Five and Dime Store, 14th Street, Woolworth's Five and Dime Store, Grant's Five and Dime Store, April 1950, Goldenberg's Department Store.
That used to be a 7th and D Streets.
Oh, okay. July 1950, Cannes Department Store, January, oh, go ahead.
That's also on 7th and D.
7th and D. Mm-hmm. January 1951, Kresge's 51, McBride's Department Store. Department Store. March 1952, Landsberg's Department Store. Okay, and so in this photo, she's marching at, for which one?
She was at Kresge's.
Kresge's, okay. So that's a picture of her. And you said how old she was here?
She was 89.
That's Mary Church Terrell. And that's a picture of her younger.
Younger.
But that is amazing. That is amazing.
She spoke four different languages: English, French, Italian, and German.
Wow.
She was educated at Oberlin, got her bachelor's degree at Oberlin College in Ohio, and her master's degree from Wilberforce.
That is incredible. Okay, and so what is this one down here?
That's the picture. What we have left of the Afro Democracy Wins at Heck Company. And if you go to original Heck Company now, that is 7th and E Streets,
mm-hmm.
between E and F,
mm-hmm.
this is called Terrell Place. In her
really?
Honor.
Really?
Yes.
Really?
And they have three beautiful statues there of her, done by Elizabeth Catlett. We donate a lot of materials there. So there's an archway, a whole wall of picked photographs that they've done leading from the lobby through the building. So
amazing.
That's a wonderful place to visit.
Amazing. That is so incredible. And so she was a Delta, member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority.
And also
yes.
She was the president of the National Association of Colored Women.
Oh, and the National Association of Colored Women. Wow. And so where are they unveiling?
Colored Women's Club.
Wow. Educator, Emancipator, organized 1896.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the oath for Delta.
Yes, she wrote.
Oh, she wrote the oath?
Yes, she wrote the oath.
Till they see this.
And this
that's amazing.
This is her desk that she did.
That's
a lot
her
of
desk?
Did a lot of writing on.
Wow.
A lot of her papers.
Wow. Oh, I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
I'm trying to get this shot. I'm bumping into the door here. This is amazing. Oh, wow. There's just so much history.
So if you read up on her father, was Robert Church, the first black millionaire in Memphis, Tennessee.
The first black millionaire in Memphis,
Tennessee.
Memphis, Tennessee.
Read his life. Robert Church.
Robert Church. Wow. Okay. Definitely will do that. So what is this over here? What is that?
Segregation. No color allowed.
Oh, Jim Crow laws?
Jim Crow laws, yeah.
Okay. Hotels, no colored hotels in the downtown area will not rent room to Negroes. This has embarrassed dark-skinned foreign visitors. Restaurants, no colored in downtown area restaurants will serve Negroes. All lunch counters, at lunch counters, Negroes must stand to be served. Mm-hmm. Theaters, no colored. Negroes will not be admitted to downtown theaters unless they pose as aliens. They are told to go to segregated theaters. Aliens, what? They were saying they were Indian?
Or Egyptian.
Or Egyptian. Oh my God.
Any country but the United States.
Wow. Most cab drivers pass up Negro patrons in downtown Washington. In the best department stores, clerks turn their backs. Mm-hmm. At the approach of a Negro. Wow. Capital gets worldwide publicity on segregation. Marian Anderson canceled. The Daughters of the American Revolution refused to permit Marian Anderson, Negro, to sing in Constitution Hall.
So she sang at the Lincoln Memorial.
And I was
about 5 months old. My mom and dad took me.
Really?
To hear her sing.
Oh my God,
Easter,
that has to be amazing.
Easter Sunday.
Okay, so the National Theater, Capitol's only commercial playhouse, is being converted to a movie theater because the boycott by Actors Equity for banning Negroes. Wow. Ingrid Bergman, star of Joan of Lorraine at Listener Law Auditorium, was shocked at the exclusion of Negroes. Mm. And what does this one say? Okay, so in the early 1870s, Washington, D.C. had a presidentially appointed governor and an elected legislative assembly. Louis Douglass, son of Frederick Douglass, while a member of the short-lived assembly, introduced an anti-discrimination law to protect the rights of black Washingtonians. The law passed on June 20th, 1872. It stated in part, any restaurant keeper, hotel keeper, or keepers of ice cream saloons or places where soda water is kept for sale, or keepers of barbershops and bathing houses, refusing to sell or wait on any respectable, well-behaved person without regard to race, color, or previous condition of servitude in the same room and at the same prices, as well as other behaved and respectable persons are served, shall be deemed guilty of a misdemeanor, and upon conviction in a court having jurisdiction, shall be fined $100 and shall forfeit his or her license until a period of 1 year shall have elapsed. A second law was passed in 1873 that made similar provisions to prevent discrimination in the city. In 1874, the United States Congress abolished Washington's Legislative Assembly and established a city government made up of three commissioners appointed by the president. The 1872 and 1873 anti-discrimination laws were never repealed by the new government, nor were they enforced.
And that's what she went to court on.
Oh.
Things that were done by Lewis.
Okay.
That's where this court battles.
Okay.
The 1972.
Okay.
Since you referred to the acts.
Yes.
So that was what you thought.
Okay.
Those
wow. That's amazing. Wow. Wow. So much. Oh, wow. Okay.
That's about it for this room.
Okay.
All these books are going up to the town hall. We have established a Terrell Langston Library there.
Oh, nice.
So these, plus we have about 400 or 500 books already filed.
Wow.
Many of them belong to her and her husband, Judge Terrell, who is the municipal judge in Washington, D.C., the first African-American appointed to the courts.
Really?
Served four terms under four different presidents.
Really?
Robert H. Terrell.
Robert H. Terrell. Okay. All right. So, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to get out of it. I apologize. Okay. So I'm going to go back and I'll show you guys the view. Oh, wow. That is incredible. So Frederick Douglass He didn't get to live here, but he sat on his porch. And Mary Church Terrell lived next door. She did live next door. This is an amazing story. They need to make a movie. They really do.
We have a book. We have a DVD.
You have a DVD?
Mm-hmm.
Where?
Downstairs.
Okay. Yeah. That's amazing. Oh my goodness. So, hello from Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur. Hi. So somebody says hello from Malaysia.
And that's where Mary Church Terrell's great grandmother came from.
Mary Church Terrell's great grandmother came from Malaysia? Really?
She was taken aboard a slave ship.
She was brought over on a slave ship?
Yes, because her family were going to be either
I don't know what to say to that. I'm speechless.
Yep.
So the person who got on here, did you know that she came from Malaysia? Shirts and all kinds of things. Mm-hmm. Oh wow, who was from Malaysia?
Mary Church Terrell's great great grandmother.
Mary Church Terrell's great great grandmother. So you have a picture?
No, I don't have a picture of her.
Okay, you have one of
her grandmother. No.
Mary Church Terrell down here.
Yeah.
Where is that picture? Oh, there she is, right?
And the one you
right
saw
here?
And the one you saw upstairs.
Yeah, that's her. There she is. So her
great-great-grandmother
came from Malaysia. She was put on a slave ship and brought here. So, yes, that's an amazing story.
We have the letter that the person whose family bought her wrote, and we had the necklace and we put it in the museum. It's in Smithsonian.
It's at the new museum? That is, okay. Well, I need to go back and see the exhibit again.
They may not have put everything out. We haven't.
Oh, that's right, right.
In the process of putting things out. So we just signed all the papers.
Yeah, it's a very old photo. Because she helped to desegregate Washington, D.C., and she was marching in her 80s. So if you go back and look toward the end of the scope, you'll see a picture of her protesting and marching. And so there she is. Yeah. That is incredible. So. And then here's another picture of Frederick Douglass. I haven't seen this one. I've never seen one of him sitting in a chair.
That was taken to Cedar Hill.
This one's from Cedar Hill. This photo was taken at Cedar Hill in Washington, D.C., his Cedar Hill home.
The line hits like the chair on the shoulder.
Oh, okay. So that's a picture of Frederick Douglass.
And that's Helen.
And that's Helen Pitts Douglass. That's his second wife.
Mm-hmm.
That is his second wife. And then this is the North Star. And then that's the 54th Regiment. It is very interesting. So, and that's Fanny Douglass.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's Fanny Douglass. And then that's Fanny Douglass at the post office.
At the post office, yes.
All right.
With the sign.
Oh, and these stamps are a Frederick Douglass stamp and a Booker T. Washington stamp?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Look at that, you guys. So Booker T. Washington has a stamp. And Frederick Douglass has a stamp as well. It's a Frederick Douglass stamp. Oh, okay, thanks.
Got a lot of stamps in here.
What else? Oh, there are more stamps?
Oh, we get the African American heritage. Yes, the more stamps. We haven't put them in the book yet.
Oh, James Baldwin. Langston Hughes.
When you go to the post office, ask for the African American heritage stamps.
Okay. Wow.
The new one's coming out soon on Dorothy Height.
Yes, Dorothy Height. That's right. That's right. Wow. Yes. Levon Julian. So I just recently met his when we had a meetup. That was a surprise. I was like, okay. These are interesting stamps. I have never seen some of these.
Quite a while. And on these other pages.
Dr. Charles.
His daughter lives right around the corner in Venice Beach.
Really?
Charlene.
His daughter lives around the corner in Venice Beach. Wow. Wow. That's amazing. Who else is out this way? Oh, there's Harriet Tubman. Oh, and that's her stamp. The Harriet Tubman stamp. So what other famous people are out here in Highland?
I don't know.
Oh, wow.
We don't consider ourselves famous, but.
Well, legendary. I don't know.
Residents.
Legendary? Yeah, it is a very nice. What about this desk?
This desk belonged to Phyllis Langston, my mom, mother-in-law.
Oh, to your mother-in-law?
And when she.
So I think I'm. Maybe I'll do this.
One in the book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess I'll do this because I've never seen this photo. I think this is really, really amazing. So please go back and watch from the beginning. Thanks for joining and thanks for sharing and thanks.